coming. I'm Jennifer Gunn, I'm the director of the IAS, and we hope we'll see you here every week. It's nice to have you here today, and I know why you came. I'm going to make a couple of quick announcements. One is that we have several events in a row today. We have our talk by George Lewis. We have a social hour around the Surdix bar area. And at 5:30, from 5:30 to 6:30, we have a reading group on Elizabeth Colbert's book, The Sixth Extinction. She will be speaking in Northrop tomorrow, a week from today, on the big stage in the evening. So please come out and join us for those. Okay, next week we have two public events related to the Heritage Inclusion and Civic Engagement New Directions in Heritage Studies Residency, which is going to take place from the 12th to the 14th next week. One, I don't have a slide for, but I'll tell you about. It's on Wednesday night, 6:30 to 8. It's titled Territoriality, Water, and Sovereignty Rights, and it will be held at the Mill City Museum. And it features five distinguished indigenous scholars. On Thursday, for the IAS Thursdays, our event will be A Sense of Where You Are, Water, Place, and Community, which is part of this larger, almost week-long residency. If you have any questions about this or want to find out about more of the activities, please contact Phyllis Messenger in the IAS office. And I'm going to introduce Diane Willow from the Department of Art, who is also an IAS faculty fellow this semester, who will introduce our speaker. But before I do that, I just want to announce that you may have noticed on your way in that the bookstore is here selling copies of George Lewis's book, most recent book, and that he is willing to sign them afterwards if you purchase a copy from the bookstore. So without further ado, Diane.
Thank you. Thank you, Jennifer and the IAS, for co-hosting with the Winton Chair Committee. I'm just going to give you a little background before I introduce our esteemed guest, Dr. Lewis. The Winton Chair was made possible through a donation our benefactors of David Michael and Penny Rand Winton. So Penny was a student at the University of Minnesota in philosophy, and they were very particular about how they wanted to support what's possible at the university. So they expressed it in this way: they want to support individuals whose work challenges cultural paradigms and represents important breaks from dominant patterns of thought. And recently, well, the past, in 2014, so now it's 3 years, a configuration of the Winton Committee, which is made up of faculty, kind of rethought how might this be possible and came up with an approach that's called the Cornerstones, of inviting people to campus who we think could help us move in new directions, both in relationship to scholarship inquiry together and individually, and maybe proposing new ways of learning together. And we are really excited that Dr. Lewis is here to help us consider the potentials and possibilities together. I just want to acknowledge the committee members who are here, if you wouldn't mind just giving a hello so people see you. So there's several people. And in part, I know it feels sort of pro forma, but it really does take a group of people to make something happen. And it is really an amazing group of people who've done this. And then very much low profile, I'm not seeing him, but I know he's here, is Aaron Lorber, who's the...
Right here.
Thank you, graduate. yeah, totally to Aaron, graduate research assistant to the committee, and who's just phenomenal and really is like the force behind making things happen. So I really appreciate you. He gave me a big prompt that I don't want to miss, which is to just remind you to take one of these if you don't have it, or if you haven't checked out the whole scene of what's going on. But George Lewis has been incredibly generous with his time and energy and ability to connect with people in so many different ways while here for this kind of marathon of 3 days. So yesterday he was in conversation with
several faculty around topics of music and queer aesthetics and also interfacing scholarship with art practice. And today we have the total honor and pleasure of his talk, Black Liveness Matters. And then this evening there's a performance, which is at 225 Ferguson. Ferguson's the School of Music. And he'll be performing and also engaging in discussion with a long-term collaborator, Douglas Ewart, as well as Monclé Nadosi. So I hope if you have the time that you can make it, I think it'll be a really amazing experience as well. And then Friday, because we were just so ambitious with our schedule, we have another conversation that's 1 o'clock to 2:30, which will take place in the Social Sciences Building. 710 is the room, but one of these little papers will be the best reminder. And that's focused on improvisation as a way of life. And I think that's a really interesting topic from so many different dimensions, so I hope you will consider participating in that if you don't have other commitments. And then our last public event is Sonic Technologies, and that will happen from 3 to 4:30 in the same room. So we tried to cluster things so that if you do have the time, you don't have to make so many transitions. So I really encourage you to come and participate. We really frame them as conversations because we're very interested in what you have to say and what you're thinking as well. So I hope you'll consider that possibility. So that brings us to the person who makes all of this possible, which is George Lewis. And you'll understand, as you listen to his talk, just how multifaceted and fluent his mind and way of connecting things in the world is. And I think that he will find so many different perspectives from which to relate to him. The kind of formal way to introduce George is through his bio, and I'm gonna do that so that you begin to get just a sense of how his creativity and intellect have sparked so many other people's imaginations and scholarship as well. And this is primarily through honors that people have recognized his contribution with. So among those, Georgie Lewis is the Edwin H. Case Professor of American Music at Columbia University. He's a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the British Academy. His other honors include a MacArthur Fellowship in 2002, and also a Guggenheim Fellowship in 2015. George Lewis is a member of the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians, which I hope you'll buy that book because it's phenomenal and available so close at hand. And he's been a part of that since 1971. Lewis's work in electronic and computer music, computer-based multimedia installations, and notated and improvisative forms is documented on more than 150 recordings and has been presented by the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, London Philharmonic Orchestra, Ensemble del Niente, Talia Ensemble, International Contemporary Ensemble, and others. His widely acclaimed book, A Power Stronger Than Itself, the AACM and American Experimental Music, published by the University of Chicago Press in 2008, received the American Book Award and the American Musicological Society Music in American Culture Award. Lewis was elected to honorary membership in the society in 2016. He's also the co-editor of the two-volume Oxford Handbook of Critical Improvisation Studies, which was released in 2016, and his opera, Afterward, was commissioned by the Gray Center for Arts and Inquiry at the University of Chicago and created and presented in 2015 at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago, where it was premiered, and then additional performance occurred in the US, the Czech Republic, and the United Kingdom. So I guarantee you that's just the briefest tip of the iceberg. Or the spark in the flame, shall we say. So thank you for coming to be with us, George, and we look forward to your talk.
Well, you know, I wanted to, I mean, you said that I was going to make it all possible, Dan, but actually it was you. I mean, I'd like to thank you first of all, for your talk earlier today in the Advanced Studies Lunch. And then also, thanks for your introduction, Jennifer Gunn, Susanna Smith, both of the Advanced Studies Institute, and Aaron, the ubiquitous Aaron Lorber. And people, other people working there, Karen Kenosha, Christina Collins, who helped me print my talk, and everyone who's been on all these panels. And there are more people I have to thank to come, like I see Mike Duffy there, and you know, we're going to be in the palm of his hand at the performance later today, if you manage to come to that. So the title of this talk, Karel Čapek meets Blind Tom. Let me just tell you what this is. This is an assemblage, and we're going to come back to that theme. It's a work by the late artist, African American artist Noah Purifoy, and I think it has some resonance with what we're going to be talking about today. This is part of it. There's a grand sort of park of Noah's work in Joshua Tree, which spans several acres, and that's just incredible array of things. So if you look it up, P-U-R-I-F-O-Y, Noah Purifoy, you'll see that there's a Noah Purifoy Foundation, and I've made a piece called Assemblage, kind of based on his work and these kinds of things. But anyway, that's not what we're going to talk about today. We're not talking about that. We're going to talk about this. In 1920, the Czech writer Karel Čapek experienced an early success with R.U.R. here, a play that has exercised lasting influence internationally. The play posed interaction and conflict between human capitalists and a new source of labor, the robota, which has come down to us in various languages as robot. Čapek portrayed Rossum's universal robots as artificial biological beings designed and built in special laboratories and factories to perform work that humans no longer needed or wanted to do. Eventually, these human-built and soon enough human-enslaved artificial people, like the golem in Jewish folklore or Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, exceed the limits of their programming and use the sentience they acquire to smash up the place and threaten good order. Rossum's universal robots, in fact, eventually destroy the human race. Now, the reasons behind Čapek's choice of the Czech word robota have been lost to many English language critics who have been content to form a basic translation of the term as forced labor. However, Čapek evidently drew upon a critical moment in Eastern European history, the abolition of serfdom. The institution of robota, or labor tax, functioned for over 400 years as a key element in the Bohemian version of serfdom. Similar systems were active across Eastern and actually Western Europe as well. Peasants were required to give the lord and owner of the land a certain number of days of labor per week in return for permission to live on and work the land, very much after the fashion of the American sharecropper. Inevitably, the robota system came under pressure, and in response, various land reforms were instituted. In 1775, Joseph II's attempts to abolish serfdom entirely were partially thwarted, leading to a form of neo-serfdom that persisted until the final abolition of the robota system in 1848. Although Čapek's play does not directly refer to the institution of chattel slavery in its various European and American forms, as one character put it, "I wanted to turn the whole of mankind into an aristocracy of the world. An aristocracy nourished by billions of mechanical slaves." Thus, we can propose a number of parallels to the condition of slaves under the US system that stand out at various points in the play. In his book On Liberty, John Stuart Mill wondered, supposing it were possible to get houses built, corn grown, battles fought, causes tried, and even churches erected and prayers said by machinery, by automatons in human form. In R.U.R., society has already been radically transformed by that kind of new technology in ways that recall the immense transformations in the economy of the American South wrought by Eli Whitney's cotton gin. Čapek's characters debate undesirable alternatives to robot-driven economic and social systems in terms that recall the centuries-long contention over the reform of the robota. Helena, what do you think would happen if we suddenly stopped making robots? Dr. Gall, standing. That would be an enormous blow for the people. Well, why a blow? Because then they'd have to go back to where they've been. This dialogue precurses contemporary U.S. concern over how agricultural and service work would be performed in the absence of immigration, legal or otherwise, as satirized in Sergio Arau's 2004 film, A Day Without a Mexican, which Californians wake up one morning to find that all persons of Mexican ancestry have disappeared. Not long after the appearance of Arau's prescient film, business classes in Georgia and Alabama, and of course this is a contemporary debate as well, as you know, the business classes in Georgia and Alabama woke up to an actual daymare as a consequence of state legislation designed to force undocumented workers to leave the state. As crops rotted in the fields, pursuant to legislators' fanciful belief that the self-deported would be replaced by good old-fashioned Americans willing and able to work, Georgia tried to solve its problems by using prisoners as robota. Chapek presents the equivalent of house robots who do the cooking and field robots who work the farms and factories. The following passage shows us that in such systems of domination, gender typing becomes integral. Helena says, maybe it's stupid of me, but why do you make female robots when gender has no meaning for them? Well, it's a matter of supply and demand. You see housemaids, shop staff, typists, people are used to them being female. A related kind of divide-conquer technique is exposed later in the play that recalls strategies used to divide ostensibly free persons of the New World, domine. There won't be just one factory anymore. Each factory will produce robots of different color, different hair, different language. The robots will be strangers to each other. They'll never be able to understand what the other says. And we humans, will train them so that each robot will hate the robot from the other factory all its life, all into the grave, all throughout eternity. We'll be making Negro robots, and Swedish robots, and Italian robots, and Chinese robots. And if anyone ever talks to them about organization brotherhood, sorry, I'll have another drink now. As Chapek's dialogue puts it, making an artificial worker is just like making a petrol engine. The simpler you make production, the better you make the product. In this way, the strict delineation of the robot's place of unswerving servitude in the system of labor is enforced. The admonition to African Americans to know your place constitutes an indelible cultural and historical mark that arguably persists to this day. However, for both robots and African Americans, knowing your place is dependent upon a certain refusal of subjecthood in terms of interiority and the capability for independent expression. The inventor of the robots was said to remove all aspects of sentience that were not useful for the purpose of work. Oh, thanks, wow. Cheers.
This is a
right here. Oh, it's not? Okay, I'll be
one
careful with that, yeah. Be careful. I'm always pretty clumsy, I gotta watch out now. The inventor of the robots was said to remove all aspects of sentience that were not useful for the purpose of work. That's to say, he threw out the man and put in the robot. Robots are not people. They are mechanically much better than we are. They have an amazing ability to understand things, but they don't have a soul. In other words, robots are objects, pure and simple, but this provides yet another occasion for me to reconsider Fred Moten's provocative observation that, quote, the history of blackness is testament to the fact that objects can and do resist. First, Moten resolves the implicit paradox of the resistant object through discursive means. By object, Moten means the black American defined as such under the condition of chattel slavery. Second, resistance can take many forms. Increasingly over the centuries, Bohemian serfs chafed at the imposition of the robota, and strikes and rebellions were by no means uncommon. Chapek's scientists recount an analogous dynamic in the workings of the robots. A couple of times, not very often, mind you, they've shown some resistance. Nothing in particular, just that they sometimes seem to sort of go silent. It's almost like some kind of epileptic fit, robot cramp, we call it. Or sometimes one of them might suddenly smash whatever in its hand, or stand still, or grind their teeth, and then they just have to go out the scrap heap. Now, in any system of domination, resistance or rebellion can be discursively redefined as glitch. And the sudden appearance of tooth grinding is clearly just some kind of technical disorder, some kind of fault in the production. No, that's their soul. You think that grinding teeth is the beginning of a soul? We can solve that problem. Dr. Gall is carrying out some experiments right now. In asserting that subjectivity is, for Moten, I'm quoting here, defined by the subject's possession of itself and its objects, the important insight is that this subjectivity can be asserted sonically through what he calls the historical reality of commodities who spoke, of laborers who were commodities before, as it were, the abstraction of labor power from their bodies, and who continue to pass on this material heritage across the divide that separates slavery and freedom. In the United States, between 1800 and the Civil War, as music historian Richard Crawford notes, quoting here again, most African American music was made by slaves. While the use of the drum by slaves was outlawed in many states, along with other loud instruments that plantation owners feared could be used to literally drum up conspiracies and rebellions, silencing was not the only strategy deployed by the slavery system. And in any case, its application was inconsistent. On many southern plantations, the ubiquitous work songs were mandated as a part of the overseer's surveillance strategies. On occasion, slave musicians would somehow break out from these restrictions, and perhaps the most celebrated example is the sightless composer and virtuoso pianist Thomas Wiggins, born under slavery in 1848, who became popularly known as Blind Tom. Among the many contemporaneous accounts of Tom's prodigious abilities, I'd like to point out just two. First, we have an 1860 account of a performance. This is cited by the philosopher of the Harlem Renaissance, Alan Locke. And this account recalls the young Mozart. He could play flawlessly any composition he heard played, usually on only once hearing it, could improvise correctly and expressively, and is said to have had a repertory of several thousand pieces. That's a list of the pieces that he could play pretty much on demand. And here's where I get to tell you, if you are have any squeamishness about certain incorrect words, politically incorrect words, you should close your ears now. Another contemporaneous account from 1860 gives us Moten's sounding commodity. Our readers will remember a recent news item giving an account of a musical prodigy in the shape of a blind Negro boy owned by a Mr. Oliver of Georgia, which the property plays the piano intuitively with surprising power. A friend who knows Mr. Oliver and is well known to the public writes the following enthusiastic account of his performance. The boy is an ugly little nigger until he touches the piano. Then the sightless eyeballs seem to be searching in the stars, and the great opera ear seems to be catching harmony from the celestial spheres. I've never heard such power, such emphasis, such marvelous fingering and sweetness from the touch of Thalberg, Eriks, de Meyer, or Gottschalk, and yet this is an ugly little cornfield nigger of Georgia. In his 1771 general theory of the fine arts, Allgemeine Theorie der Schönen Künste, Johann Georg Seltzer proposed that we would be able to hear Begeisterung, or inspiration, in Beethoven's improvisations, if only we had been there. Seltzer understood that inspiration proceeded from the music itself, and not only from perceiver's response, and was particularly excited on an English builder's 1749 plans that would convert fantasien, i.e. improvisations, into written notation. Daphne Brooks has luminously called Blind Tom's performances sonic slave narratives. At the same time, Tom's narratives, like Beethoven's, were also set down in written form as notated compositions committed to paper by editors. We saw one of the covers of one of the scores. I'd like to suggest that just as we can hear the traces of Beethoven's improvisations in his piano sonatas, hints of Blind Tom's sonic narrative are present in his written compositions. In his 1863 work for piano, The Battle of Manassas, Tom deploys the classic American trope of musical depiction as thunder, lightning, and the sounds of cannons are recalled via cluster-like sounds that anticipate early Henry Cowell, the futurist composers, and avant-garde artist Stan Douglas's a use of La Marseillaise in his groundbreaking 1992 video installation, Orchon. And that's a Douglas Ewart in part of the installation. So let's listen a little bit. Let's listen to a bit of the Battle of Manassas. Thank you. Song of the Shank, a recent historical novel about blind Tom by Jeffrey Renard Allen, probes the relation between sound and soul in the context of 19th century American conceptions of black subjectivity. Early on, Allen's white characters confront the challenges Tom's music poses to this conception of black subjectivity. One of Tom's owners wonders, can he wish? Can he aspire? Can he set goals? Other than in the bodily longing of a chicken desiring feed, a bird desiring a worm, a duck drawn to a pond? Other than in the set demands of nature, essentials such as the changing of the seasons or the earth's need for rain? In R.U.R., musical performance is marked as quintessentially human. Domine says, do you play the piano? Helena says, yes. That's good. But a working machine must not play the piano, must not feel happy, must not do a whole lot of other things. For Chapek's industrialists, man is a being that does things such as feeling happiness, plays the violin, likes to go for a walk, and all sorts of other things that are simply not needed for activities such as weaving or calculating. Thus, Chapek's robots are fated to only limited subjectivity. They learn how to speak, how to write, do arithmetic, as they've got these amazing memories. If you read a 20-volume encyclopedia to them, they can repeat it back to you word for word, but they never think of anything new for themselves. They make very good university lecturers. maybe you know about this. There was a recent, I guess what's happening now, I read about this, somehow Noam Chomsky was talking about it, that they were wanting to make a movement where papers would be created by machines. And so that was one response. So for Chapek's industrialists, no, sorry about this, for Moten, the truth behind the value of the commodity is tied precisely to the impossibility of it speaking. For if the commodity could speak, it would have intrinsic value. It would be infused with a certain spirit, a certain value given not from the outside. In the Allen novel, as in Tom's actual life experience of the reception of his music, debates about originality versus mimesis in The Negro congeal into a complex of paradoxes, all prompted by Tom's undeniably intelligent soundings. This is from the novel. Between us, we have arrived at a scientific evaluation of a Negro boy who goes under the name Tom, a slave boy who was approximately 7 years of age and fraught with all the handicaps of his race, but who can also demonstrate elevated and refined musical sensibility at the piano. He possesses the muscular ability to reproduce by hand and voice many of the finest selections from the European catalog. Let's see if I can do that here. This is in and of itself remarkable, since the Negro's thought organ is generally a lifeless and submissive receptacle with no power of specific reaction to anything challenging or demanding that might be introduced to it. So much so, the Negro's imitative abilities are usually little better than those of a parrot. The emerging resolution of the paradox is that Tom, like any Negro, is doomed to mere mimesis and state of nature essence rather than the originality of the creative spirit that marks the complete human. The basic tenor of that side of the debate, in its most crystallized form, is on offer in Mein Kampf. From time to time, our illustrated papers publish, for the edification of the German Philistine, the news that in some quarter or other of the globe, and for the first time in that locality, a Negro has become a lawyer, a teacher, a pastor, even a grand opera tenor, or something else of that kind. It is a sin against the will of the eternal creator to allow hundreds of thousands of highly gifted people to remain floundering in the swamp of proletarian misery while Hottentots and Zulus are drilled to fill positions in the intellectual professions. For here we have the product only of a drilling technique, just as in the case of the performing dog. Well, this is the sort of thing we are bracing to experience now. In fact, you know, we're already experiencing it. Let's look at this. Philip Auslander wrote that classic book on liveness, portrays the concept of live music as a discursive response to a crisis brought on by advances in the technology of recording, which led to radio listeners' inability to distinguish between live and recorded performances. The word live was invoked to contain this crisis, according to Auslander, through a revised discourse that could pique the imaginations of listeners. In the early 1960s, Advances in recording technology allowed the binary opposition between live and recorded to be exploited to lasting effect by a young audio engineer, Edgar Vilcher, whose fledgling speaker company, Acoustic Research, was made famous by his staging of live versus recorded concerts in which human musicians would perform live with a pair of Vilcher speakers behind them. During the performance, the musicians would stop and the tape performance would go on. Many reviewers of the day could not tell the difference between the live and the recorded sound. However, the use of classical music for these demonstrations was not just for the purpose of attracting well-heeled, high-class customers. Jazz was only one of the musical genres in which LP records of live performances were prized, but jazz's particular claim to liveness was here was based, despite Adorno, in its reputation as improvised and spontaneous, being made in the here and now, you are there, as the title of a 1950s U.S. television show had it. The performance instructions for a piece of classical music constitute a stored program for the recovery of stockpiled time and could easily be juxtaposed with analogous stockpiling on tape. Such comparisons could not be performed with music like jazz, which is improvised on the spot in both major and minor details. By 1972, however, audio equipment companies had figured out how to use jazz, or the image of jazz, to invoke the live versus recorded binary. Now, here's an example.
You are now hearing the Memorex cassette tape recording we just made of Ella. Is it Ella, or is it Memorex?
I'll never tell.
Sometime in the mid-1980s, let me see if I have this down here. Sometime in the mid-1980s, I attended a performance with a barrel organ player in a Parisian jazz club. Instead of the usual popular folk songs and military music, this guy's organ roles included ranges of jazz compositions. Taking a bow with considerable applause after each number. After a couple of tunes, I struck a conversation backstage with the musician friends who were trying to account for this. In that light, it made sense for me to venture that since the guy was just turning a crank and the sounds were being controlled by a stored program, the whole thing could have been done by a computer. Someone responded, well, no, the barrel organ had an acoustic sound, presumably much richer than the sounds of synthesizers. And someone said, oh, no, that could be it, said another, since it's the 1970s, Chick Corea, and that was a Chick Corea tune, used to play great solos on synthesizers that could only make sine waves, sawtooths, that kind of stuff. So maybe the intelligence animating a sound, enlivening it, counts at least as much as the sound itself, or even becomes a part of the sound. That's an echo of Sulzer's notion of Begeisterung in Beethoven, you know, the infusion of spirit, Geist. Eventually we concluded that it was the guy turning the crank that kept the audience interested. Not that the, you know, he didn't seem to be cranky in a very sensitive, intense way, you know. I mean, when you see the concert, no matter what the piece was, he cranked pretty much the same way. You know, it was around midnight, you know. And it was all much the same. And so, you know, it was the visible marker of physical human presence that satisfied the audience that it was real, live performance was taking place. I mean, look, the crank could have been a fake. The performer turns a non-functional crank while an electrically operated barrel organ plays the music. Now, if you've been to Amsterdam, you've already seen that. You know, the guy sitting there, he's jingling this box with money, and the money is doing it in time, he's cranking, but it's all done by the machine. Now, another scenario involves the pretense of cranking while a real-time music composing process is controlling the barrel organ. I'm going to venture that all these possibilities could give the impression that a live performance was taking place, and that such an impression was grounded in the imputation of human physical presence and activity, serving as a medium or source for musical communication. Now, by the crank, I'm going to now include a musician and tape program pieces. If you remember those, it'd be fixed media, which they now they call fixed media, used to call it tape, musician and tape, clarinet and tape. I'm going to include pieces in which dancers and tape. I'm going to include a lot of those things. All those things somehow have a sense of like, I realized at a certain point that I didn't need, when I was making these kinds of pieces, were interacting with computer programs and all that, I thought, well, I didn't need a crank because I was the crank. From Alexander Scriabin forward, Western artists have sought to explore synesthetic links between sound and color. Now, in this 1988 painting by Jeff Donaldson, one of the founders of the Afrotober art movement in the 1960s, what we find is basically a steganographic synesthesia of liveness. The steganographic images of Donaldson's, well, who are these people? Or are there people? Who do you see? Anybody recognize anybody in this picture? I know you got another guy over here. Well, the sound file I'm going to play for you is going to, you're going to know when I play the sound. The steganographic images combined with the riot of color stands in for the riot of sound Donaldson welcomes in a represented jam-packed, jelly-tight, performative assemblage. Anybody got a big answer who that guy is with the microphone? James Brown. Who said James Brown? James Brown, yeah. All right, James Brown for 100. There you go. Who is James Brown? Now, the guy in the middle is Muhal Richard Abrams, who is also heard playing piano on this made-up track. And the bassist is Charles Clark, who was an early member of the association. So this is in a way a memorial to him because he passed away in 1967. But, you know, the idea behind this is that I'm looking at this idea of this sort of seeming riot of color, this color. Afrotober artists came up with this idea. They wanted to have figuration. They wanted to have representative artwork. They weren't into abstraction as such. But they wanted to have very bright colors as their means of invoking the African or the neo-African or the trans-African. And so they call these colors Kool-Aid colors. And they're supposed to be colors that everybody could relate to, that were very bright, very, very pronounced. And so that having as much packed into the moment as possible. Now, the polar opposite of this is, let's say, Rothko Chapel, you know. So, and that was definitely something, an aesthetic in which, although they were respectful of it, they didn't feel it represented their circumstances. Now, talk isn't really about Afrotober, but I want to give you a sense of the relation between sound and sensibility that's animating a lot of this talk today. The invention of magnetic tape recording in 1935 enabled schools of composition based on the stockpiling and rearrangement of time, for which the primary medium of presentation was playback of previously recorded sound. Magnetic tape then, as I said, digital fixed media now. For some composers, tape and later synthesizers promised maximal clarity of expression, free from the inevitable errors associated with performer mediation. Others felt that something was lacking and were seeking solutions by adducing or at least invoking the corporeal, a term widely seen as a new engagement with liveness. The advent of interactive electronic music in the late 1960s was an outgrowth of the notion of live electronic music, a real-time practice using electronically modified acoustic sounds that differentiated itself from electronic works whose primary medium of presentation was magnetic tape playback. Gordon Moomer's Hornpipe, 1967, for horn and electronics, appears particularly prescient with respect to what was coming in the interactive computer music of the 70s and after. And this is Hornpipe is discussed in Paul Sandman's book, Liveness in Modern Music. He has a pretty interesting interpretation. Mine kind of deviates from that, but here we are. In this case, as I read Hornpipe, the performer treats the electronic feedback system, which you see here, this is basically the score, as a quasi-independent co-performer. And it's interesting here because what you guys, we talked about this earlier about the nature of listening and how Jennifer Gunn talks about asking about a particular score that Diane Wells showed on the screen, and there's in the center of the score by Paulinelle Brown, you see this thing that says listen. And most scores don't have an explicit invocation to listen. But this one does, because you can see right here, is that the channel two in, and then there's channel one out. So we've got inputs. This is a composition that has inputs. It's listening to the outside world implicitly. Okay? And then it puts out all this stuff, and then what you get is some distillation of what it's hearing on the outside. And the electronic electronic feedback system becomes a quasi-independent co-performer, and the performance becomes a reciprocal mediation between the exhibited behaviors of human and machine actants. Improvising robots, along with the Mars rover, which is my absolute favorite. The early 2000s, look, the Mars rover is fantastic. It's like, we talked about this the other day, the Mars rover is basically like Booker T. Washington, you know? You know, you could think of the thing, they drop the thing down from orbit, and, you know, it's like casting down your bucket where you are. You land on the planet, you look around, you see what's going on, you start making actions, start making interventions, you start testing things. It takes, what, 8 minutes to get a signal from Earth? That's not fast enough to do anything. No. So the machine has to have its independent life and intelligence. So that ends up being pretty important, you know. And they're just starting to figure out now that these kinds of architectures are basically improvisated. Okay. Like some of the more recent theorizing of, let's say, you know, Rodney Brooks style subsumption architecture. You know, it's a means of creating improvising machines. So this humanoid robot, Leonardo, created by MIT researcher Cynthia Brazil, and animatronics innovator Stan Winston, you know, the Jurassic Park guy, appears to exercise awareness beyond the limits of Muma's console.
Hello, Leo. Leo, this is Cookie Monster. Can you find Cookie Monster? Leo, Cookie Monster is very bad. He's very bad, Leo. Cookie Monster is very, very bad. He's a scary monster who wants to get your cookies.
Now, what we have in these cases, for me, is a kind of composed liveness. A notion that I offer in the wake of Čapek, one that also moves away from the live-recorded dichotomy, or for that matter, the transformational dichotomy, toward an agency and subjectivity inflected view. And here I'd like to invoke one that Benjamin Pickett and Jason Staniak's investigation of deadness. Pickett and Staniak challenge Outlander's view of the connection between liveness and mediatization. as they write. We see liveness as co-constituted with deadness. As a result, and you know this, you know about this whole thing, as not the result of mediatization, but rather as the necessary labor arrangement of intermundanity between the worlds, the connection between the worlds, the living and the dead, as exemplified by Natalie Cole's unforgettable duet, with her legendary father, Nat King Cole. Chapek also posits his characters as dependent upon a necessary labor arrangement between the two worlds, the humans and the robots, which, while not alive, are exhibiting liveness. Now, everybody knows about the blindfold test. If you follow the jazz world, you know about it, anyway. I'll tell you what it's like. It's a journalistic appropriation of a widespread listening practice in which listeners played recordings for each other, asking them to identify the artists. Years ago, I had made some cassette recordings of one of my early computer improvisers. I make computer music improvisers, you know, sort of do independent things. They're like musical robots, kind of. And I made a recording of one, performing by itself, and I was traveling in Europe. I ran into the art ensemble of Chicago's trumpet player, Lester Bowie, who was sort of a mentor. I ran into him in the Brussels airport. So I gave Lester a blindfold test. I said, who is this? No, he said, no, that's actually, that is the punchline. He put the headphones on, listened for a while, and said, who is this? Now, Bowie's query highlights an affective network comprising liveness, sound, subjectivity, but without the crank. He could have said, what is this? I would have been very disappointed. So I had to tell him who it was, or what it was. Now, we're going to give you a blindfold test, except you don't have to answer. Just think about the question, who is this? By neuroscientist Chris Frith and Uta Frith, the social brain, allowing humans to boldly go where no other species has been, takes as its conceit an attempt by humans stranded on an alien planet to communicate with a previously unencountered species. This sci-fi motif prompts a number of strategies, not for determining sentience, but for establishing communication and the role of autonomous agency. First, the authors observe that the social brain has a theory of mind that enables us to predict what others are going to do on the base of their desires and beliefs. This work is based on Uta Frith's work on autism, followed on the 1940s work of Fritz Heider and Mariana Simmel, who showed that subjects presented with animations of basic two-dimensional shapes tended to ascribe intentions to those figures. Now, while the two scientists focus on establishing a neurobiological basis for social behavior, for this talk, I'm more interested in the signaling behavior deployed to establish the communication. These signals are of two types, involuntary and voluntary. According to Frith and Frith, one does not need to intentionally display biological provenance. Rather, one cannot help doing so. Every time we move, we send out involuntary signals about ourselves. We call that public information that tells others we are agents. Observing movement, we routinely make predictions and inferences as to what kinds of knowledge and beliefs the mover might have. Experiments have shown that we can differentiate biological motion from other types of motion, and we can recognize gender and emotion from movement as well. Okay, so I'm going to summarize this. Voluntary signals, deliberate signals, are sent when an agent wishes to attract attention. An agent receiving these ostensive signals, it would be a wink, even a wink, will be trying to infer the intention, nature, and content of the message. Other important ostensive gestures, reciprocation, in which a change of gestures takes place, accommodation, and the kind of reputation building in which consistency of intent is established via repetition. It leads to trust, which happens to be an important ethic in improvised music. So I find this paper truly remarkable in that virtually all the signaling strategies the authors cite involve the parsing of physical gesture. None involve the parsing of sonic utterance. But there are strong implications here for musical improvisation. Improvisers routinely report being able to understand goals and intentions through sound, and one might wonder where the theory of mind can be heard and played musically. In fact, this is something that all three of us were together in 1996 at a conference, a month-long conference in Copenhagen, which we discussed these very possibilities of whether theory of mind could be heard musically. Moreover, these questions closely track the encounter not only with unknown biological species, but with interactive computer programs and installations. With that in mind, we're going to remove the blindfold. Jerry's information is being sent to the laptop, which is interpreting it in various ways. And then that influences what the laptop does to play the other piano, which is being played via MIDI on Yamaha disc clavier. The thing is about it, just to be give you a bit of explanation, as usual in my music, Jerry could walk off stage, and then the computer would notice that and would start playing on its own. It doesn't need Jerry to play music. So in fact, if it did, it would be much less interesting, I think, for the pianist, because the pianist is looking for something that will give back to the environment. And delay lines and things of that sort tend not to do that. And the musicians hear right away that nothing's being given to them, something they would expect from human or sentient musician. So, or at least a musician that's paying attention. So it's not electronic music, but it's basically a dialogue between two improvisers playing acoustic grand pianos. And thereby, I wanted to eliminate assumptions about liveness based on differences between acoustic and electronic sound. Now, for some, the computer piano might seem more live than the other pianist is playing, but also when the music is being encountered without the visuals. And that's something we can kind of think about. So I wanted to, before I conclude, I want to sort of have us think a little bit about Andrew Pickering, sociologist of science, and his notion of dances of agency, I think, is pertinent in this context. In Pickering's ontology of agency, like Moten's, objects perform. Dances of agency, this is an actor network kind of way of thinking about things. Dances of agency are themselves performative, not linguistic, cognitive, or whatever. They have to do with actions, human and non-human, in the material world and the interplay of those. Pickering's positing of a push-pull dynamic of resistance and accommodation, which I think actually marks the way, not only the interaction between these two entities, but also actually the way my computer programs operate. Sometimes they accommodate and sometimes they resist. And this is at the heart of the struggle between the human and material realms for Pickering, in which each is interactively restructured with respect to the other. And that's something I can suggest we hear. We can hear this if we listen long enough in the dialogue. Can we hear a shared intention? And can we hear this kind of resistance and accommodation? So at times, sonic acts that appear to present themselves as unfriendly at first can be reparsed as resistance, deviating from imitation to establish a space of difference. In the push-pull of resistance and accommodation, you build your reputation, you establish trust, improvisation becomes a sound of negotiation, an autopoietic, interactive musical behavior that operates independently and in dialogue with the viewer's, auditor's constructing gaze and activities. It's not a simulation of actual musical experience, but it is music making itself, with real world outcomes and consequences for other spheres of human endeavor. Chapek's play is often interpreted as a critique of scientific irresponsibility, but it seems clear that a major danger Chapek's characters saw in the emergence of the robots is that, like the protagonist of the film Blade Runner, they were successfully able to pass as people.
Helena, jumping up.
Oh, that's absurd. Sulla isn't a robot. Sulla is a girl like me. Sulla, this is outrageous. Why do you take part in such a hoax?
I am a robot.
No. No, you are not telling the truth. I know they forced you to do it for an advertisement. Sulla, you're a girl like me, aren't you?
I'm sorry, Miss Glory. Sulla is a robot.
Chapek's robots pursue imposture as a survival tactic, and the analogy to racial passing is too obvious to ignore. As Irving Goffman noted in the 1950s, the more closely the imposter's performance approximates to the real thing, the more intensely we may be threatened by it. For a competent performance by someone who proved to be an imposter may weaken in our minds the moral connection between legitimate authorization to play a part and the capacity to play it. So let's go a little bit further with Helena's astonishment.
It's a lie.
Excuse me, Miss Glory, that I must convince you.
Enter Marius.
Marius, take Sulla into the dissecting room and tell them to open her up at once. When they've cut her open, you can go and have a look.
No, no! You wouldn't have her killed.
You can't kill machines.
Now, another example of the problem, and I found this a very interesting story, supposedly from a Chinese text from 3rd century BC, describes the presentation by, there's a lot of early invocations of robots and automata in classical Greek and also classical Chinese literature. Describes the presentation by a mechanical engineer of a life-size human-shaped figure. It walked with rapid strides, moving his head up and down so that anyone would have taken it for a live human being. It began singing, perfectly in tune, so far so good, okay? But as the performance was drawing to an end, the robot winked its eye and made advances to the ladies in attendance. Whereupon the king became incensed and would have had the engineer executed on the spot had not the latter, in mortal fear, instantly taken the robot to pieces to let him see what it really was. So those are the consequences of what Ishmael Reed called reckless eyeballing. The robot suffered the same fate. The same fate as those innumerable Southern Black Americans to whom Emmett Till gave an unforgettable face. It was lynched, and order was restored in the kingdom. This is because, as new media artist Antoinette Lafarge notes in an essay on improvisation and imposture, and that's in our other book, actually, the Oxford Handbook of Critical Improvisation Studies, which me and Benjamin Pickett co-authored, which just came out. But it's famously expensive, until it comes out paperback. To talk about imposture, according to Lafarge, is to talk about personhood and social identity. According to Lafarge, people spend enormous amounts of their lives creating forms of order precisely to reduce or prevent improvisation. Laws, regulations, customs, traditions, ethics, all are normally designed to inhibit improvisatory response. As with the prohibitions on racial intermarriage enshrined in both U.S. law and custom until the 1960s, the goal would be to prevent the improvisation of imposture, a natural threat to social order. Lafarge's essay invokes both race and gendered passing. And of course, passing is also a theme in this new movie, Get Out, which we were talking about recently. This is all connected with this. More on passing. So this turn, late in the discussion, allows us a brief excursion in the direction of Masahiro Mori's notion of the uncanny valley, which asserts that as the behavior of robots becomes more and more human-like, or in Mori's formulation, he means visually, that is, a point arises at which they become less familiar to us and more uncanny, even to the point of provoking aversion. It has occurred to me this phenomenon extends beyond our encounter with robots toward any substantive exchange with entities previously regarded as subaltern objects who suddenly begin to speak. In the context of electropolitics, Barack Obama's ascension to the U.S. presidency might be viewed as an example, or even the non-election of Hillary Clinton. Some partisans continue, despite all evidence, to regard his occupancy of the office as simple imposture, again evoking extreme aversion. Both Rossum's universal robots and Blind Tom evoke the uncanny in their beholders, but the source of the uncanniness is in the beholders themselves and in their views on sentience. The aim of Čapek's industrialists was to avoid producing sentience in the robots. Their perspective of Tom's environment was to deny full humanity to him and others perceived as being like him, who chose not to accept these signals of agency and subjectivity. And this is where we encounter the political and social dimension that permit the current epidemic of dysfunctional police interactions with black citizens, which has everything to do with Obama and the uncanny valley, the notion of black lives matter. If the higher symbol and Uta Frith experiments show that we can impute agency to inanimate objects based on gesture alone, surely we could do so for humans, or can we? According to Allen, the late neuroscientist Oliver Sacks described the discrepancy between Tom's everyday behavior and his apparent genius to autism, a view that in its most narrow would leave little room for the effect of racial dynamics. Allen's novel re-dramatizes the pre-20th century representation of Blind Tom as something akin to a freak of nature, not because of musical ability alone, because of the evident provenance of that ability. Dear sir, the underlying desire to express our thanks to you for the opportunity afforded them of hearing and seeing the wonderful performance of your protege, the blind boy pianist Tom. We find it impossible to account for these immense results upon any hypothesis growing out of the known laws of art and science. Remarkably, well after Blind Tom performed the freak at the behest of P.T. Barnum, the gay black minimalist composer and pianist Julius Eastman, who I gave a talk about yesterday, referred to himself in a 1976 interview as a kind of talented freak. Now, talented we can understand, but what made Eastman a freak? His extended vocal range, his blackness, his gayness, or assemblage of all of these and others. The remark evinces Eastman's understanding of his own presence on the American experimental classical music scene as inherently counter-performative assemblage, just as Blind Tom's was. A particularly evocative paragraph that Daphne Brooks uses to describe Tom seems equally apposite for Eastman. He is the noisy slave, the one who sounded outside multiple sociocultural spheres. He is the heterophonic captive who, like his brethren, sang in response to and conversation with one another and produced a symphony of sounds that spanned the dimensions of his environment. His sonic quality of doubleness is simultaneously complicit with and critical of the ideology of those who dominate. Now, the fear of a Nat Turner-style rebellion was never far from the minds of Čapek's roboticists, and indeed their society eventually comes under attack from robots bent on throwing off human rule. I think this is it here. Robot soldiers, here we go. Show no mercy to local population. More than 700,000 massacred. They cease to be machines. They're already aware of their superiority, and they hate us. They hate all that is human.
Robots throughout the world, we, the first international organization of Rossum's universal robots, proclaim man as our enemy and an outlaw in the universe.
In an eerie echo of what has come down to us through a history of slavery and slave rebellions, one of Čapek's industrialists exclaims, good heavens, who taught them those phrases? But all robots looked alike to them. We made the robots' faces too alike. 100,000 faces all alike, all facing this way. 100,000 expressions as bubbles. It's like a nightmare. It was criminal of old Europe to teach the robots to fight. Some of the robots disobeyed the communique that you just heard. One, named in fashion after a human, begins to play the piano, even as her fellow robots burst in and massacre her human associates. Finally, we can connect the sentient-sounding commodity with Houston A. Baker's identification of two contrasting African-American expressive strategies, mastery of form, cryptic masking, exemplified by Blind Tom, that in Baker's words, conceals, disguises, floats like a trickster butterfly in order to sting like a bee, and Eastman's deformation of mastery, a phoneric strategy that distinguishes rather than conceals. It secures territorial advantage and heightens a group's survival possibilities. Using primate behavior as an example, Baker notes that the gorilla's deformation is made possible by his superior knowledge of the landscape and the loud assertion of possession that he makes. And it was this raucous post-Stonewall assertiveness that proved unsettling to so many about Julius Eastman. Now, at one point in Jeffrey Renard Allen's book, Tom is asked, how does it feel to be a nigger? Tom's reply, a nigger is a thing of no consequence. In contrast, Eastman, noted for the titles of his pieces, Evil Nigger, Crazy Nigger, Nigger Faggot, saw the field nigger trope as the engine of radical change, and his sense of intersectionality draws him to invoke the same image about what he called the gay gorilla. That is the reason why I use the term gay gorilla, he says, in the hopes that I might be one if called upon to be one. Just as rebellion and resistance are the keys to self-realization for Chapek's robots, there is a larger dance of agency that is the key to a range of expression, from Blind Tom's sonic slave narrative to Julius Eastman's spiritual emancipation. Like most of my discussions of present and future sentient technologies, musical computers, self-driving cars, military drones with the power of life and death, what I'm really talking about is the crucial place of critical Afrohumanism in charting our course. This lets us realize that Karel Čapek and Blind Tom are meeting at the humanist crossroads where Eshu Elegbara awaits. So there you go, thank you. So if anyone has comments, questions, complaints, any of that, I'm happy to take them or whatever you like. I mean, it was a pretty long slog, right? Sorry. I tend to go on and on. Please go ahead.
Well, first of all, I wanted to thank you for coming. Your presentation was very fascinating, and I really enjoyed it. And,
thank you.
So my question would be, a theme in your presentation is you talk about them to robots, and that you first demonstrate this in the screenwriter, I cannot pronounce his name exactly, Karel Čapek.
Karel Čapek, yeah.
Čapek,
playwright.
Playwright, yeah. He refers to house robot versus field robot. And my question is, could you explain that comparison a little bit more? Is it like sort of systemic how like African Americans have been treated, sort of like robots? Is that the statement he's trying to make, or?
I don't think he's trying to make a statement about African Americans at all. That's what I found very interesting, because a lot of people have assumed that he is making these kinds of remarks about African Americans because they see the parallels right off the bat. But the term robot, as I was trying to point out, doesn't really refer to African Americans. It refers to a dynamic of Czech history, which is to say the robota system, which the term comes from. So a lot of people haven't really noticed that. I think he's talking about conditions of chattel slavery. I don't think he's necessarily talking about African American. Well, he's not talking about it, and I'm not either. I'm talking, not saying that African Americans are like robots. But what I am saying is that African Americans under the conditions of slavery, and really you can extrapolate that now, the issue is, what happens when the slave speaks? There's a certain point at which a certain dynamic of slavery disappears because it's dependent on the idea that slaves are objects and have no minds of their own, no rights that we're bound to respect, to quote the Dred Scott decision, and so on. So once you start to speak and talk back, you resist, that ends up being the moment which you have to be reckoned with as a subject. So that's basically what I'm talking about. Anybody else there? Anybody? We start drinking now? No, go ahead. No, please, go ahead.
You know, I really would like to stop talking, but it's so much silence and it bugs me, so I end up, this is me being an undergraduate again. So one of the things that was interesting about your talk is like you didn't talk much about value and meaning in terms of, like, so if you have these computers or these objects, like improvising and, you know, in certain places mirroring back or doing different things in response to, like, an artist, is that entity, that the electronic entity, actually producing a particular type of language or meaning that can be discernible? And so, And then my next part of the next question. Right.
Can I start there?
Yes, go ahead.
I don't see why not. I mean, yeah, we don't remember the second part, because I don't. This first part is worth talking about by itself. improvisation is not just the performative production of, let's say, of anything. It also involves attending. So we have to attend, we interpret. As I said yesterday, I have a very low bar for what constitutes improvisation. First being accepting the condition of indeterminacy as constitutive of the environment, asserting agency partial within that condition of indeterminacy, the analysis of conditions, which is also partial. We can't listen to everything. We have to sort of choose. And how do we choose? We have to improvise the choice, so we're back to indeterminacy again and agency. And then finally, the moment of choice, the choosing itself, which seems ineffable, like collapse of a wave function. We can be on either side of it. We can justify the choice based on whatever we like, either before we do the choice or after. But we don't really know. The choice is there. I don't think there's any way to say that we can be sure what motivated the choice. So that's my bar. That's everything else I find to be sort of add-ons that don't touch, that we can take off if we need to. So in the case of, let's say, Jerry Allen, and the whole, if you want to watch the entire videos on YouTube, we have a conversation with the philosopher Arnold Davidson, me and Jerry, if we talk about what it's like to play with machines. And the thing is that people who play with these things don't really care if they're machines. It's not what they're thinking about. They are interacting with their environment, and their environment includes something, and they know a lot. In other words, they are listening to this thing and trying to figure out, what is this thing trying to tell me? What messages are being conveyed? What kinds of meanings are coming forth? How is it approaching what I do? How is it deviating from what I do? And that ends up being something that improvising musicians such as Jerry Allen are uniquely and brilliantly equipped to do, because that's part of their métier. They spent their lives learning how to do that. And so, but the thing is, we've also spent our lives learning how to do it too. So maybe not as musicians, but maybe in some other aspect of human endeavor in which we start to think about, well, how do we interpret our environments? You know, a simple example would be you come home after a hard day at work and your loved one says, so how was your day? You say, okay, you know. Now, the ubiquitous computing machine that's listening to your conversation says, well, she seems okay. Or a smarter version says, well, no, there's something wrong there. And so the thing is that at some point, that business of it being a machine is something that no one has time to think about or care about. And that's the larger point I'm making, that if we start to look at the utterance not in terms of its meaning and the kinds of meaning that's being transmitted, but in terms of who the sender is and what our belief systems are about the senders. In other words, we can sort of say, well, who said that? Or we can say sort of, what did you say your name was, Shaniqua? You know, well, no, we don't have any apartments for you. Or if it's, or your voice kind of sounds funny. You don't sound like Dan Rather or something. I mean, these kinds of things, you know. That's what I'm trying to say is that at some point, that complex of interaction between sound, the making of the sound, is what frees you, I think, in some sense, from the, having to, it provides that sense, if not of sentience, but certainly of agency and subjectivity. So from Jerry Allen's perspective, whether there's an essentialism of subjectivity isn't really her project. Her project is to explore the situation. What's your second question?
If I ask you, it's a little philosophical, so it might take
go for it.
Time.
No, we want the philosophical. That's why we're here.
And so then my second question will be, can an object, and I spent like at least part of my summer reading Fred Moten in the break, and so,
yeah.
So in some cases we're reading some of the people. But can an object unto itself that is not necessarily projected onto it by, you know, the human or the human subject. So in other words, like, so I mean, and this is very crass. Like, okay, you know, I mean, maybe the machine can have value of itself, but like, can we actually have a value of ourselves that is not inherently dependent upon the projection of that? And I'm thinking, so I'm thinking maybe like Siri, like you can talk to Siri or Asana or whatever type of digital thing, and you can actually have a conversation and they can say funny things and make you laugh and convey emotions, but that meaning or that value itself only comes from the thinking that I'm doing and attributing to it. So in other words,
let me think about it. Okay, we think about computers in particular. Now, my son likes Siri a lot. And he asks this, he continually asks this one question of Siri. He asks, is God real? And Siri's response has been very variable over the years, but the latest response, which you can check for yourself, and he's been asking that question of Siri since he was like 9. And so now he's 12. And the latest response is agnostic. I try not to mix spirit and silicon. Now, to me, this is clearly a canned response, okay? But it needn't be a clearly canned response. I mean, the thing is that once you're in the stage where these machines learn and develop, maybe the problem is that Siri is controlled by a corporation that doesn't want to take a stand on whether God is real. But not all robots are. And so the other interesting thing was the racist robot, the Microsoft chat, the racist bot, who developed, he fell in with a bad crowd, Steve Bannon and those people, and the alt-right, or the sort of basic Nazis, I mean, who sort of got hold of it. So a lot of it is that, that's the funny thing where what you're saying is, it brings up in one sense the old nature-nurture dichotomy, you know. And then, in the other sense, it brings up sort of a sort of social theory, like Anthony Giddens' ideas about technology, which is to say that technology doesn't have the agency apart than that which is imputed to it by humans. Now, a Bruno Latour response would be more like, well, objects have differential forms of agency. And so if we're talking about, once again, the idea of a robot or a machine or whatever. And we think of, and as Čapek said, music was thought of as one of the signal achievements of the human spirit, which is why, you know, I've been making musical robots for 38 years. So I've heard just about every argument if people don't like them or they don't, they think, you know, they shouldn't be done, or that somehow they are angry when they find out that it wasn't a person that did it, or any of that kind of thing. And I mean, they're the Google Magenta people who are trying to make robots that do this kind of thing now. And if you listen to it, I think they have a little ways to go. But eventually they will get there. They have more money than I do, for one thing. So, but yes, it is a philosophical question about agency. It's a philosophical question about reader response. You know, the idea that we're looking for, but in the musical sense, I know, this is an example. One more thing I forgot to say. The question is, does the robot do just what it's programmed to do? And the answer to that is yes. But that programming can be really complicated. And you may never find out, get down to the basis of which part was programmed, because it's all programmed. But the programming is just the starting point. It's in the interaction where you get the capabilities. And maybe the simple things like Siri's sort of theological agnosticism, you know, you can sort of tell. But in other cases, maybe not. I mean, anyway, that's my musing on at the moment. Yes?
I wanted to ask about freedom. So there's, you know, one strain of the anthropology of ethics that says all this talk about agency is kind of asking the wrong question.
Mm-hmm.
No, what we're really concerned about is freedom, right? So if we have like a actor network theory and agency, it allows us not to worry about freedom. All we're concerned about is capabilities and mutual implication. But
right.
If we're going to talk about slavery, you know, chattel slavery and serfdom, freedom seems to be kind of a major issue. And then if we want to talk about whether we can ascribe ethics to these musical robots, that also would seem to be a question. So, you know, canned responses certainly are, you know, this is not freedom. But to what extent would you be willing to ascribe freedom to any of these robots?
Well, this came up in a funny way. You know, think about Ornette Coleman, you know, free jazz and all that, 1960s. You know, freedom is kind of on the agenda. And so what you find is that it's the freedom is on the agenda largely because of the what they had exposed, these musicians, these new musicians, Albert Eiler, John Coltrane, the others, as very scripted musical situations, which mirrored the very scripted and ultimately oppressive situations they're experiencing in the social realm, the political realm. So free jazz, I think, for me, is about exploring what happens when those externalities are removed. So if you want to call that a kind of freedom, but I'm going to also say that I think freedom, I don't want to say it's relative, but I'm going to say that it's you're free with respect to a given standpoint. In other words, you have to be free with respect to your interlocutors, the extent to which you are not under coercion. And so what I find is that these robot musicians, and I don't think I want to make an essentialist argument about freedom, just say, oh, here's the freedom subroutine, or I wrote this to be free, or whatever. It's more a matter of the emergent working out of these things is where we start to find that freedom becomes an achievement between two entities which may not have the same understandings of ethics or intersubjectivity or freedom, but which are operating in the same space anyway. So that as people observing that space or as people who are interacting with that space, that becomes an issue of how they achieve the kind of freedom they're looking for. Does that help in some way?
Yeah.
It's a very odd way of looking at it, but you know, geez. Yes, please.
Thank you for your talk. I have a question about the title of your talk. I want to ask you, it is fascinating to me, I'm hearing what you just said about the relationship between the robot and the human, and the binary of human and non-human.
Mm-hmm.
You're playing on Black Lives Matter, and I want to ask you and see what's the difference then between liveness and life? Is it a condition of being in relationship to being human or not? So when you are talking, what makes liveness in the context of music matter, and what makes life not matter? So why is that Black liveness matters?
Well, I guess I'm saying that both matter.
Right.
But I'm saying that you're asking me why other people don't believe that Black Lives Matter. That's a very complicated situation. And I don't want to speak for them because I'm not interested in what they have to say. So there are lots of reasons why people might believe that. But I guess my approach is more to draw the connection between life and liveness, and it might run through the acts through the direction of freedom, which seems to be the place where we don't want these people to be free. We want them to be subject to certain kinds of control. I find that the current administrative situation, the current government situation we have here in the US, some people are being told in a variety of ways that we're going to put you under control, and you're not going to be free to say anything or to think anything. You have to watch what you say, you have to watch what you think. And in those cases, liveness disappears. And also, your life is under threat at that moment. So the connection between life and liveness seems as intimate as you can imagine. And so liveness in the person of music, for example, is what leads us to the point where we can think about life. Life without liveness is not really life. And liveness is something that is not scripted, okay, which is something that we look at as being not given from the outside, under no real constraints that we can see, or with the power to interactively compose and throw off constraints. Okay, so in that sense, that's why I'm saying I'm not really able to speak to the dysfunctional dynamics of those who believe that black lives don't matter. But my purpose in this talk is to draw parallels to show, demonstrate in the end, the emergent understanding that life and liveness do matter. Yes?
If I may offer something of a triangular question or comment in that regard, I was thinking as you spoke about how the use of body cameras is meant to provide a check on racist cops, right?
So-called.
Right?
Then they turn them off.
So they turn them off, but someone like, you know, Philando Castile, who was killed by racist cops here, right? Was live streamed.
Mm-hmm.
Was live streamed.
Yeah, we all saw that. We all saw that.
Exactly,
yeah.
Right? So in that sense, I think there's something to think too about how liveness reinforces the value of life there in a very different sense in our contemporary live streaming age, right, in the age of Facebook Live. I think, yes, it's a dialectic, but right? I don't think they can be reduced to one another, but I think it's an important thing to think through, right, how life has so little value, that liveness is kind of revitalizing its value.
You know, I'm not sure I'd go along with that. Let me tell you my interpretation of that. The guy's life was ebbing away on camera. You can't say it didn't matter, you know? I mean, to anyone who was actually, it had any spark of humanity. And so there we were watching it, and even if it was recorded many times afterward, it wasn't, quote, live anymore. There was still the residue, the traces of liveness that were present. And also because it wasn't just, we weren't just experiencing it through the stream. There was a network of associations, people who knew the person, people who were had experienced things like that themselves. I mean, the first time, I was 9 years old the first time I experienced one of those encounters with the police. Oh, you mean to say, truly, you know, you got a report of someone that looked like me and robbed something? And it's ridiculous, right? Why would they bother with that kind of thing? So I'm going to say that I'm still going to stick with my original response to you, and that is that the life did matter, and I'm going to agree with you that the live presentation of it, the liveness, the mediatized liveness of it, reinforced the importance of life. And I'm going to go a little bit further than that to say that liveness has been kind of hijacked by reality shows and a lot of fake liveness, which seems to devalue or have the intent of devaluing human life in some way, so that what we have here is a situation where much of the many of these shows are designed to alienate people from their families and from their loved ones and from their societies, and to place them in little autonomous bubbles of one. And a lot of the technologies that we are seeing now, which are very popular, all of you have special headphones, you know, the little things you put in your ears, you stick on your iPod. Let me tell you something odd about those headphones. I'm just going to go off the grid for a second on this. You know, I remember when the Walkman thing came out, the cassette one, right? I remember that. So, you know, I lived in New York City, and I put the things on, and I realized that I was always bumping into people.
Yeah.
Not because I wasn't watching them, but because somehow I lost some sense of echolocation and triangulation that the airphones are interfering with. And I thought, wow, this can't be. I mean, we can't echolocate. I mean, Alvin Lucia kind of showed that. You know, we can't echolocate. But maybe we could, you know. But then there's the other problem of, like, what do we do? There's lots of studies, right? People put on headphones so they won't be bothered in the New York City subway, or that people, you know, they don't want to talk to a homeless person demanding money, or any of these kinds of things. They just walk past that. So we have to lock out those societies. Noise-canceling headphones, which Jason Stanyak and others have talked about. These kinds of isolating technologies. And so I look at something like this, the thing I just showed you, as the precise opposite from that. And here's one other little minor story from my long and quasi-interesting life. I lived in Paris in the 80s, and I was working on this kind of computer music stuff there. And then an opportunity came to work with a famous philosopher, Jean-Francois Lyotard. And it was going to be a fantastic thing. And this station actually went up. It was called Les Immatériaux. Okay, Les Immatériaux, right? It was called Les Immatériaux. And the idea behind Les Immatériaux was that they were going to have everybody walking through this sort of active space, but they're all wearing headphones. So they're all isolated, walking through this space and wearing these headphones and experiencing on a personal basis and being as isolated as you could sonically from what the rest of the environment was doing. And he had a sort of a point to make about subjectivity and society, but it wasn't a point I was interested in. And so I stepped out of the project because I didn't believe that wasn't what we were trying to do. That wasn't what we thought technology was about. We were making interactive technology to bring people together and to have dialogue and to think and have people think about the consequences of dialogue and be in a sort of ubiquitous computing space where, you know, you remediate technologically the environments that we live in, these already live environments, and we just add to those livenesses. So that's the part that I found was under-theorized, where people like in Xerox PARC had already thought through these ideas about ubiquitous computing that Lyotard was kind of valorizing in some way. So then the show went up, we weren't in it, but what we did was instead, we made another piece that went to the science museum, La Villette, and stayed there for 7 years. What it was mbira, like a kalimba, they call it. We found out, in doing the research for the piece, we found out that kalimba is actually not a real African name, but it's a sort of a trade name made by Hugh Tracy, the South African guy who made the thing. So mbira is the actual name. So we made these mbiras, and we made them electronic mbiras. So you played them, it was very, very responsive, and you could not only play music with them, but you could make images with them too on the screen. So you could drive them around the screen, you could make images, everything. And they put that up in the Science Museum, and you know, the night, because you know, these installations are always the same, right? It can always work a little bit better. You don't want to let go. Mm-hmm. You know, you sit there and think, I'm sitting there, guy comes up to me. First of all, this is a piece of quasi-public art in the museum, okay? We brought they said, well, what are you going to use for interface? And I pull out this mbira, and they say, what's that? None of them had ever seen one, all these French bureaucrats. Yeah. So you live with all these Africans, you've never seen one of these things. So then the night we had to close up, you know, some guy who was obviously from one of the African countries said, can I try this thing? So I said, sure. Started playing it. The guy could really play the damn mirror. We couldn't play it. He said, this is cool. Or say chouette or say home, or whatever you say. I said, well, this is who we made this kind of thing for. That kind of notion of embedded interactivity, that kind of cultural opening up, so that some people were privileged, some people's experiences were central, or at least not negligible. And this is the one of the things I worry about with technology, when accounts of technology ignore not only gender, but race, ethnicity, emergence of different spheres in which technology could, you know, change lives. When I see this kind of thing, that's what we're there to do. I don't believe that technology has to be alienating. And so that's why I took myself out of the project and found another way to get paid.
So. Well, the conversation can continue downstairs on the west side of the building. Let's thank George.